Legion Field opened in 1927. It is one of college football's oldest stadiums and home of some of the greatest moments in the history of the sport. Tonight, it's the site of a battle between two of college football's infants as the South Florida Bulls take on the UAB Blazers. Good evening, everybody, and welcome. Sean McDonald along with Craig James. Delighted to have you with us. These are two newcomers to major college football. Both schools started football in the 1990s. Both made a successful jump up to Division 1A. The next step is make it to a bowl game. They've been eligible before, but never picked. UAB becomes eligible to win tonight, and they're in this position, Craig, thanks to a terrific offense.
I look forward to watching Darrell Hackney play. UAB has a quarterback that is really talented. He's a big, strong guy. Hackney can throw the football. He can throw it deep. He's got a strong arm, but he also has touch. I look forward to seeing that touch. He has a receiver in Roddy White who can get down the field. He's a long strider. They say that he can get down the field and get beyond you before you have a clue what happened to you. So, very impressive, powerful offense.
Averaging 36 points per game, 11th in the nation. South Florida has had a tough year. Just two victories due largely to penalties and turnovers. Also, some inexperience and injuries. They need to make a late season run to become bowl eligible. And it's the quarterback, Pat Jelmyst, who, like their season as a whole, has been kind of up and down.
You know, it's just up and down. And, you know, he has to play strong and be consistent and start off well. Because of his inconsistencies, along with the injuries they've had, it's been a very erratic offense. With him playing, though, he has to have some efficiency on the ground from Andre Hall. Hall is a very talented runner. He's a JC transfer. He's come in here. He's surprised everybody. And apparently has a lot of ability. Look forward to watching it tonight.
We're back in Birmingham, just a moment away from the kickoff tonight for South Florida and UAB, and we're delighted to be joined by Heather Cox.
Darrell Hackney, from an X's and O's perspective, but what about Darrell's mental edge? Darrell is about as superstitious as they come, so before every game, offensive coordinator Pat Sullivan gives him a lucky penny. Then it's Chris Williams who really steps it up. He's the big spender, gives the quarterback, fittingly, a quarter. Darrell then puts him in his pads for good luck. Now, what makes this superstition a little unusual, it actually rings true. For every game that UAB has won this season, Darrell's had both coins in his pads. Now, the two games that they've lost, Tulane and Florida State, Darrell was without the lucky quarter. The key, of course, to any good superstition is consistency. We'll see if this 26 cents is the magic ingredient tonight, guys.
All right, thank you. Interesting superstition, Heather. And certainly not much has changed since you played college football, Craig. People used to hand you a lot of money from what we've been told.
Hey, I'm just going to go right above your comment. I'm going to tell you, I used to put my left knee pad in first, my right knee pad, left thigh, right thigh. Nobody could touch my pads.
Well, here's the important number as far as this game and these seasons have gone. South Florida has really hurt itself with turnovers and penalties. UAB won the toss and deferred, so South Florida receives the kickoff from Nick Hayes. And Andre Hall takes a knee in the end zone. Pat Jelmyst is the quarterback. He won a battle in the preseason with Ronnie Banks to be their starter. And despite the inconsistent play, he has remained their starting quarterback. Some days he's brilliant, other days awful. They had a 324-yard passing game in their win over TCU. He's coming off a four-interception game shortly thereafter against Southern Miss. Last time out against Louisville, he was 3 for 20 passing. So they hope he'll be the good Jelmyst tonight. He pitches it back to Hall. And a tough run for six out to the 26. Bobby Keyes, the cornerback, made the tackle for UAB. The South Florida offense, Peyton is a true freshman receiver. And you'll see a lot of freshmen and sophomores. It's a young team. The veteran group is the offensive line, anchored in the middle by the center, Alex Heron. Brothers just returning from injury at guard. Second down and four. Heron, the starter, is making his 34th straight start for the Bulls. Quick pass out to Jackie Chambers. He's another freshman who expects to see more playing time as they look to the future, which includes a move to the Big East next season. UAB's defense last time out gave up 59 points in a loss at Tulane. The strength of the group, the linebackers, they combined for 343 tackles last year. And in the secondary, Keys, Register, Cosper, and Evans.
First and 10 after a gain out to the 38, a pickup of 12 on the pass play. Two Chambers, now straight up the middle, Hall. Out to the 43-yard line, a first down gain of 5.
And you can see that they've simplified really what they do. You'll notice in this game when they go to the line of scrimmage, they're going to make a lot of calls at the line trying to play cat and mouse with the defense, but that's no problem because defensively they just go up to the line too. There's a little cat and mouse game that'll go here, and the team that can run the ball is going to have a clear, obvious advantage in this situation.
Second down, 5. The tight end Mike Ruger goes in motion, a 3-wide receiver set, and the option pitch back to Hall. Nice moves, and he has one man to beat. All the way down to the 17-yard line. A 40-yard gain for Hall, who rushed for 200 yards earlier this season in their loss to Army. And South Florida on the move into the red zone.
You know what? You're going to get some nice blocks from the inside, but on the outside, 81 S. Green, he's going to come in there, and he does a heck of a job of blocking on Will Evans, and then it's just Hall down the field. Hall, number 2, has a lot of vision, has enormous ability in the words that they use from the coaching staff.
3 carries, 57 yards already. 4.
Man.
Bang down by Nigel Eldridge after a gain of 3 to the 14-yard line. Eldridge is senior from Montgomery, Alabama. And if you don't hear much crowd noise in your TV right now, it's because there isn't much of a crowd here at the moment. That is the more crowded side of the stadium. Temperature 70 degrees and very humid. It rained almost all day here, and the forecast was for some severe weather possible in this area tonight, which has certainly kept the crowd down. J.B. Garris, the wide receiver, got a couple to the 12-yard line. And it's a shame, Craig, because this is a great opportunity on national TV for both of these teams. Jim Leavitt, the South Florida coach, and Watson Brown, the head coach at Alabama Birmingham and athletic director. He was hoping for a bigger crowd here tonight to cheer on his team and to make it look better on national TV. They've had some of their biggest crowds in the history of the program this year.
And, you know, you talk about Legion Field, it's 83,000 it seats, so when you don't have a big crowd, it really, really accentuates it.
Shotgun with 3 wide receivers. No rush at all, but the pass is batted down. Sam Williamson, the defensive tackle from Greenville, Alabama, brings up 4th down, and the field goal unit comes on for USF.
And give you an idea, eyeball level, really, what Jewel Miss is looking at. 90 Williams, you see him go up, the timing of it, the pass, just a big wall of men in front of him. But a very impressive start so far offensively for them.
Santiago Gramatica trying a 29-yard field goal, and it is good. That's the 37th field goal of his career. He is now the school record holder. He has been tied with his brother Bill. 3-0 Bulls. Tonight, the 7th day of 19 consecutive days of football on the ESPN family of networks. South Florida, an impressive opening drive. Bogged down deep in UAB territory, and Gramatica kicked a 29-yard field goal, capping an 8-play, 68-yard drive. Gramatica with a short kickoff. Down to Jason Southall. He finds a seam along the numbers, and the kicker, Gramatica, stuck his head in and made the tackle after a 31-yard run back.
That's a pretty darn impressive tackle by a kicker in the open field, but you can see it open clearly here. The way they get up the side of the field, and then watch Gramatica 7 come in, ducks his head, which really threw the runner off.
Reggie Lindsay didn't even bother blocking Gramatica. He ran right by Gramatica, figuring, hey, that's the kicker. There's no way he's going to make the tackle. He went to block somebody else. And Gramatica did indeed make the tackle. He separated his shoulder earlier in the year, warming up. During the game against Army, he felt a couple of the cadets hit him on purpose while he was kicking in the warm-up. Darrell Hackney, the quarterback, taken down for a loss. Curtis Chance, another one of those freshmen, seeing more action of late, took down Hackney, and he's a load to take down. They list him at 6'2". He's probably not that tall. 235 pounds. He's probably a little heavier than that in actuality. When you see him, he looks like a linebacker. He has a terrific arm and touch. Watson Brown, who's coached a lot of very good quarterbacks, says he has the best combination of a deep ball and touch in the short and intermediate game as any quarterback he's coached. Corey White is the lone running back behind him with two tight ends on second and long, and he's showing that deep arm, has a man out there. It is caught. Touchdown, but a flag down to the line of scrimmage. We talked about the big play capability of Hackney and White in the opening, and on the second play from scrimmage, it's a touchdown if it stands. But there was a flag thrown to the line of scrimmage by the official on the far side of the field. And it looks like it's coming back. Barry Anderson is the referee.
Number 11.
Repeat, second down.
Yeah, Reggie Lindsay, Sean, he's coming in motion up top, and he just you just see him right up here, how he comes down. Watch right before the ball snapped, he kind of leans towards the line of scrimmage. A little Canadian football for you there. Doesn't work down here in Birmingham, Alabama. But you see the ability to stretch the defense with that arm. Powerful arm, big arm down the field. Of course, Roddy White ran right through that thing. 4 to 5 different pro scouts over at their facilities this week watching film, trying to evaluate Roddy White. The guy can play.
126 yards per game. Receiving, leading the nation. Hackney a little bit high through the hands of Lindsay. So Lindsay's off to a tough start. Didn't block the kicker on the return. Moved early to negate a touchdown, then had that go through his hands. Burks is the starting tailback, but we'll see a lot of White as well. We already have. And up front, Rogers, Galloway, Batusik. Quentin Harris has been the surprise of their entire team, and Julius Wilson. Harris was a scout team player when camp began, but he just kept knocking people down and impressing the coaches every day. And by the start of the season, Quentin Harris had earned a starting guard position. Third down and 18. Absolutely no pressure on Hackney, and the catch made, and the lunge, I believe, got him the first down. Roddy White, the big play wide receiver, picks up 21.
Sean, you talked about the right guard, 69. Watch Harris. Gets the big body, rifles him down inside, and you know, if you're going to try to come into his house, you better come with more than a buck 85.
He had been a defensive lineman. I don't think he was quite nimble enough. He's battled weight problems. He was a first baseman on the baseball team in high school at well over 300 pounds. He said, yeah, guys were surprised when they got the first base and saw me standing there. Not your average-looking first baseman. Hackney with a design roll and the receiver open. It's White again. That's good for 15 more. So they've had two connections for 36 yards and the touchdown. Wiped out as well. Trey Williams defeated in the coverage. Leroy Selman Jr. returns after missing their last game against Louisville after arthroscopic knee surgery. His presence should help. Steven Nicholas, one of the best linebackers in college football, along with St. Louis and Moffitt, had a very young secondary with two freshmen, Trey Williams and Danny Verpail, along with Kamen and Brown. The secondary has been particularly porous. The last five games, South Florida has given up an average of 38 points per game. Morris Drinkert with another flag down. Some nice moves along the far sideline. And he got inside the five before Sidney Simpson got him on the ground. Drinkert's a guy who can play running back or receiver. And as he says, I'm a playmaker. Wherever he's been, he has made plays. A 22-yard gain if it stands.
Kind of doing a little going down the field at will here.
The last time out, we'll wait for Barry Anderson. He's still not quite certain.
Holding, number 78 on the offense. 10 yards from spot of foul. Repeat first down.
Julius Wilson called for the hold, and that'll bring it back.
Sean, you mentioned Selman. and his ability. Watch what he does when he gets to the backfield in this particular play. He gets up, he pushes back the ball carrier. Anytime you make the ball carrier deviate from his path 3 yards deeper, somebody from the inside has to get out there. Of course, the holding call on number 78, Wilson, pulled down the safety who was trying to fill that void, and that's why you had the big run.
Brings the ball back to the 30-yard line. First down and 15. And the shovel to Drinkard. And he goes to the 25-yard line, 4-5. Let's check in again with Heather Cox.
Sean, yesterday I had the chance to talk to Darrell Hackney about the keys to this game, and he said early on the first drive, I want to go deep. Well, sure enough, he did that. I don't think he anticipated the flags he'd find in this the first drive. He also said, I want to throw on rhythm, be patient. If I do those three things, I don't have to worry about how many points the defense allows. Of course, that comment referring to the 59-55 loss last week to Tulane. He says if he gets the points on the board, he's taking care of business, guys.
Well, that was a stunning result for UAB, which had won four in a row, then went to Tulane to take on a team that had been struggling. Big hit on the outside there as Roddy White made the tackle, and Bruce Gibson, who was playing wide receiver earlier in the season, now plays both ways, made the tackle.
You know, and you know, this is an inexperienced, banged up secondary, a nice job, but you see White just wait on it. Just kind of, you know, just come back just a little bit and you make sure that you don't get smacked as quick as that. But this South Florida secondary just decimated, changed up a lot of different positions because of injuries.
How about what Heather was talking about? The game at Tulane last week, UAB had 649 yards of offense, did not turn it over once. Hackney passed for 448, White at 253 receiving, and they lost. Hackney lunging for the first down marker. And it looks like they're giving the spot for the first down. Sidney Simpson, a junior safety from Titusville, Florida, made the tackle. But it is a first down. And that was a devastating loss for UAB. Looked like they would have won their fifth in a row for the first time as a Division I-A program. They would have been 6-1 overall, in all likelihood in the top 25 in the country. They were 24th in the BCS rankings and just out of the AP and coaches top 25 before that loss. And they'd be undefeated in conference and in a tie with Southern Miss and Louisville in Conference USA. Corey White working hard and near another first down, down to the 5-yard line.
You know, Sean, you talk about their rankings. As an AP voter, I had them in the top 25. You know, so I believed a couple of weeks ago that they were a pretty darn physical, talented football team. And you know, and that's what's, you know, we start talking about these mid-majors playing. They can't afford, the good ones can't afford to have a slip up along the way.
Watson Brown trying to get his team into a bowl game for the first time. They were eligible in 2000 when they went 7-4, in 2001 when they were 6-5, but not invited. 5-7 each of the last 2 years. Last year's season resembled what USF's going through this year. Lots of penalties, lots of turnovers. They've solved those problems this year. Timeout, South Florida.
As the rain comes down, there's more rain that's going to come down on this defensive line. You see the weight variation right there? That offensive line at UAB has a distinct advantage in weight. So you're going to get some push on the inside. We're going to keep our eye on the linebacker level here tonight. Let's see if South Florida's linebackers are making plays up in the gap. They can't sit back and wait on them.
Second and one. They're trying to lean on that offensive line to pick up the first down, and Corey White does. Javen Kamen made the tackle. And Southern Miss. And Burks took the handoff and was tripped up by Stephen Nicholas, the outstanding linebacker. He was a freshman All-American last year. Sophomore from Jacksonville, their second leading tackler this season.
You know, just seeing it, you know, when you got a ball carrier, a football player like that that's keeping his eyes on the ball carrier, I mean, on the ground or not, he's got a chance of making the play, just never giving up.
Repeat, first down.
Offside the call.
Watch Nicholas on the ground, knows where the ball carrier is going, uses his whole body.
Blew up Marcus Elliott, the running back, trying to block him. Penalties have hurt South Florida all year. He showed you the turnover margin numbers, among the worst in the country. They're also near the bottom in penalties, and there's a touchdown. Corey White takes it in. And the Blazers have the lead on a 2-yard touchdown run. Fifth rushing touchdown of the season for the sophomore from Birmingham, Corey White. He made it hard on themselves during the drive. A couple of penalties wiped out big plays, but still UAB goes all the way down the field to score the touchdown. On the Blazers' first possession of the night, the extra point is no good. Nick Hayes has missed two in his career out of 106 PAT attempts, and both misses are against South Florida. He missed one last year in Tampa. He's missed the second of his career here tonight.
That's that Gramatica deal.
On this rainy night in Birmingham, Alabama-Birmingham with a 6-3 lead over the University of South Florida. The touchdown by White capping a 12-play, 53-yard drive. They took more than 5 minutes off the clock, 5:06. The length of the drive. Hayes, after the point after miss, sends it into the middle of the end zone, and it's down by J.B. Garris. Well, we mentioned only two career misses with this miss by Hayes. In his career, he's 104 out of 106 now in point afters. Both misses against the Bulls. He just hooked it. Last year in Tampa, he redeemed himself by kicking a game-winning 42-yard field goal with 9 seconds left to give them a 22-19 win over South Florida. That was the only meeting ever between these two schools prior to tonight. First and 10, South Florida, and it's Hall who keyed their drive for the field goal, has his helmet ripped off. And a quality run of 8 out to the 28-yard line, pulled down by Galen Black.
Good vision. They said he had excellent vision and a good burst to him, and right now UAB's deciding to stay back and really a 2-deep coverage. There are only 7 inside in the box, but if he keeps running the ball that well, they'll bring somebody else up in there and see if they can hurt him with a pass.
No surprise that each team scored on the opening drive, given the way these two defenses have played lately. Hall belted by Sam Williamson short of the first down. Hall got a hard-earned 1 yard before he got walloped.
Well, they say that number 90 Williamson is a solid football player. I would say that's bigger than solid right there. That welcomed Hall to the inside tonight. That'll set your pads if you haven't had them set yet.
295-pound junior from Greenville, Alabama. Third down and 1. And they give it to the fullback, and Clinton Crossley looks like they gave him a good spot.
Yeah.
The official on the far side of the field running in beyond the 30-yard line. Boy, from here, it looks like he was down and then bounced the ball across the 30. Larry McSwain in on the stop. It is a first down for South Florida.
Well, number 90, Williamson, he right now is controlling on the inside.
Quick pass, and it is incomplete. Intended for Andre Hall. Hall, in his first year at South Florida, and they needed a playmaker. Brian Fisher, who was their MVP on offense last year, has had a lot of off-the-field problems and not playing this season. He had played running back, wide receiver, and quarterback last year. So Hall, a junior college transfer, looked upon immediately to make an impact, and he has. He's their leading rusher, averaging 91 yards per game. He's from St. Petersburg, Florida, not far from the USF campus in Tampa. Second and 10, and the flip goes inside to J.B. Garris, and he gets nothing. Stopped by Nigel Eldridge. Already the third tackle of the night for the senior Eldridge.
You know, misdirections, watch the tight end 48 come around, and it's almost like a counter with a far side H-back moving and coming around trying to block out, but on that particular play, UAB went nowhere. They're kind of settling in right now trying to stop that running game.
An offense that has had difficulty most of the season, as you saw in the numbers at the top of the telecast. Here comes a blitz, a flag down. It looked like the Blazers were offside. And the catch made for a first down. Johnny Payton, a very highly recruited true freshman out of Dade City, made the catch. Looked like Jermaine McElveen was offside. And South Florida would turn that one down.
Offside. Number 98 on the defense. Holding. Number 74 on the offense. The penalty's offset. Repeat third down.
Chris Carruthers called for the hold, and that is a costly penalty, and that is a phrase that South Florida fans have heard over and over again this season.
And, you know, penalties right now at this point really slowing down both teams. When they're out here on offense, it's false starts, it's moving here and there, it's holding. And for Jewel Miss, they can't afford for him to have positive plays called back. They need some positive plays for him.
Near the bottom in penalty yardage, 83 penalty yards per game, 113th out of 118. Jewel missed on third and 10. Going deep with single coverage down the far sideline, the jump ball, and it's incomplete. Intended for Johnny Payton, he was well covered by Bobby Keyes. Say Keyes had him locked up. But again, you don't have to say that. In fact, I wish you had said that.
You know, one of those nights.
It could be. Good play by Payton to break that up. Keyes actually had the better position. There's Brandon Baker on the punt. A walk-on onto the program in his second year as the starting punter. And Reggie Lindsay leading Conference USA and 14th of the nation in punt returns at more than 15 yards per return. Won't have a chance to bring that one back as it's out of bounds along the far sideline at the 39-yard line. From the 39-yard line, first and 10, Hackney was 4 out of 5 on the opening drive. The incompletion was a catchable ball through the hands of Lindsay. Plenty of time to throw. Man breaking open. White is just a little bit too long. Boy, White is running open deep down the field over and over again. Bruce Gibson, who they moved back to the secondary due to the injuries and inexperience, had the coverage, but he was a couple of steps behind White.
And let me tell you this. This is one of those six-second routes. If you get a six-second route going, kind of fumbling around, then he goes to the corner. There's no way. And with the arm that Hackney has, I mean, you see that little breakdown and go back to the outside? I mean, they better figure out a way to get to Hackney and not allow routes that take 5-6 seconds to develop.
Teams have been blitzing UAB a lot. They've dealt with it very well. No running room for Dan Burks. He's their leading rusher this year, back healthy after missing most of last season. Craig Coble made the tackle for the Bulls of South Florida. He's the leading sack man on their defense. The senior from Lake Worth, Florida, has 5 sacks, led them with 6 last year.
And you don't really know what to expect from this defense, who's going to step up. A lot of youth, a lot of inexperienced guys on the field, and the coaching staff is not sure who's going to step up and be the guy. There's good and bad of having to play the young guys, right? Mm-hmm. It's tough to deal with it when you're going through it.
Here's co-defensive coordinator Rick Kravitz. He's on the field. Wally Burnham is fellow defensive coordinator is up in the box. Rick Kravitz has been with Jim Leavitt from the beginning. This is the 8th season of football at South Florida. Well, just as we come back live to Legion Field, torrential rain now. As we mentioned, there is the possibility of some thunderstorm activity here in Birmingham tonight. We were told by UAB officials that the radar close to game time looked like most of the severe weather was breaking up or moving away from this area. But it's raining very hard right now. Third down and long. Hackney throws, incomplete. He was looking for Bradley Chavez, who's had some difficulty hanging on to the ball, and he might have heard the footsteps there of Javen Kamen, who delivered a pretty good lick after Chavez could not come up with the ball.
Yeah, very well timed. You can get rid of the word potential on the rain. It's here.
Yeah, the rain is definitely here.
Yeah, watch
Ernest.
Yeah, watch the timing, though. Safety coming over. Just as Hackney gets the ball off down the middle, well-thrown football. Beautiful touch. That's that touch that they were talking about. Coaches were raving about not only his big arm, but his touch.
Pat Sullivan, the former Heisman Trophy-winning quarterback at Auburn, is their offensive coordinator, and he says that Hackney throws the deep ball as well as anybody he's been around. Excellent punt with the wind, a bit too long, 62 yards. Parker Mullins, longest of the season for the punter for UAB, and the ball comes out to the 20 for South Florida. There's Pat Sullivan, and boy, it's great to see him looking well. He battled cancer during last season, a very emotional time for him and the team. And throat cancer was the ailment plaguing Pat Sullivan, but he told us yesterday all the recent tests have been terrific. He's back to a full schedule. Missed only one day last year. Get chemotherapy on their off day each week so they can continue coaching. Andre Hall out to the 28. 8 yards on first down, and you wonder if this heavy rain will limit the offenses here with 3 minutes to go in the first quarter.
Yeah, it might restrict it a little bit, but when you talk about the running game and Hall and his vision, getting up into the line of scrimmage, you'll see he makes the nice cutback, but he's got to get back up into it. Get back north. Get back north. You can't continue to make the cut all the way back. You got to cut and get up the field.
Seven rushes, 71 yards for Hall. He got up the field heading north very quickly that time. Brandon Register recorded another tackle at the 37. That's a gain of 9 and another first down for the Bulls.
I always thought as a runner, when it got wet, it was easier on you because you were wet and you kind of slip and slide right by tacklers, right? Much more difficult to be tackled when you're wet. You're shaking your head. You agreeing or not?
I was just thinking of something that I decided I would not say. I wish I did that more often. Hall out to the 40-yard line. Eldridge made his fifth tackle of the quarter. It'll be second down and 8.
I saw your edit man working over there. You know.
Yeah. Every now and then you have to have the governor kick in.
He did.
It is just pouring. Sheets of rain.
Poor Heather.
A few fans who are here have moved up underneath the upper deck, and I hope they're careful on the other side, because what we've been told is that upper deck has been condemned. It is actually going to be taken down after this football season. Hall for a loss. The defense rallied quickly. Eldridge having an enormous first quarter. That's his sixth tackle with help from Darius Taylor. Here's Heather Cox. We hope she's dry. Heather.
Certainly not dry, but this is what college football in the fall is all about, guys. Andre Hall, though, is in the mood for an 8th touchdown. Actually, before this drive, he went over to Terrence Royal, gave him a towel, and said, "Don't give this back to me until I come from the end zone." In rain like this, he's going to want to get in the end zone quickly, get a towel to dry off a bit, guys.
Thank you, Heather. He heads to the sideline now. He does have 7 rushing touchdowns, 2 shy of the school record for a single season. Of course, the school history spans back just 8 years. Started playing in 1997. Boy, on third down and 10, an interesting call. Jewel missed. Was not known as a runner. Took off, and Larry McSwain made the tackle. Jewel missed, rushed for his career high 73 yards last year against UAB. Surpassed that in 1 game earlier this year. He's not much of a runner.
This falls under the category of playing smart football, right? Don't try to throw the ball right now while the rain's coming down like sheets. Go ahead and punt it, play field position, and see if it doesn't ease up, and don't put your offense in a bind.
And Baker punting into a pretty good breeze. They came after him, and the flag is thrown. Good punt, given the rush, the wind, the rain. It goes all the way to the 21. Usually it's the referee who throws it when they hit the kicker. That came from the linesman on the near side of the field.
Go ahead, hit the button.
A Barry does plenty of conferring before you get the call.
Hold it. Number 28. 10 yards. Repeat fourth down.
Well, wise to have him do it again, given the wet ball and the breeze that he's going into, and the fact he got off a pretty good punt, and they almost blocked the last one.
You know, we're sitting up here thinking maybe that they were calling something a hit maybe on the punter, but the bobble threw the timing off, and clearly you could see the holding down the bottom left there. But as a punter right now, you have to consider using your body to make sure you catch that snap. Ball's a little heavy coming back there wet.
Baker's a junior from Lake Placid, Florida. Reggie Lindsay back for the punt. Standing at his 33. Fourth down at 18. 26 seconds to go in the first quarter. The play clock running out. And they just did get the snap off. Wobbly line drive kick. Lindsay lets it roll. Dead at the 34. 37-yard punt. We take a look at the standings. That loss to Tulane last time out was critical for UAB's conference title hopes. They're looking for some help now. It ends in a tie, and Southern Miss and Louisville do not play each other. The Liberty Bowl will pick which team it wants to come to its bowl game as the conference champ. They would both be regarded as conference champions, but in the event of a tie, the Liberty Bowl gets the pick.
And they're going to pick whoever brings the most fans to the stands and the best TV audience.
I think Louisville is the best team in this league in terms of talent. The way they played, certainly they're very exciting to watch with that high-powered offense. Dan Burks, the ball carrier, he got back to the line of scrimmage. He's tackled by Ben Moffitt. Burks, a local product of Vestavia here in the Birmingham area. And that's the end of the first quarter. End of one quarter in rainy Birmingham. The home standing Blazers lead South Florida 6-3. Sean McDonough with Craig James and Heather Cox back in Birmingham, where torrential rain continues to fall at Legion Field.
That means heavy.
Very heavy. Lots of it. Coming down in sheets right now. UAB going into the wind here in the second quarter, leading 6-3. Each team scored the first time it had the ball. And a conservative handoff to Corey White. I think this helps South Florida, upset minded. They wouldn't mind a sloppy track, maybe some difficult ball handling.
And slows down Roddy White.
Diminish the deep down the field throwing game of UAB. Rain, 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 a big part of the story. While it was just raining lightly, USF took the opening kickoff when 68 yards, a 40-yard run, set up a short field goal by Gramatica. Hall took it to 40 yards, and then UAB on its first drive, 12 plays, capped by Corey White's fifth rushing touchdown of the season from 2 yards out. After the loss of four by Burks, it's third down and 14. And White gets the 14 and more. All the way into South Florida territory. That's just terrible defense by the Bulls, and it results in a 26-yard run for Corey White.
Nice call and a nice run. Watch the fullback 89 come up inside and block on the linebacker 51, cuts him down. And then it's just a matter of getting in the secondary and running, holding on to the football. Typically in weather like this, it's feast or famine. You know, you're going to have a big, you're having nothing.
Problem with the chains now on the far side. They got tangled up with some of the South Florida personnel.
But this weather really does help South Florida's defense in slowing down that speed of Roddy White. We've already seen one call back. He ran right past them early in the game.
With the heavy rain, harder for Hackney to throw the ball accurately, and obviously the wind is picked up with this rain. They couldn't cover White while it was just a light rain and relatively light wind. They really haven't tried to throw it to him since This front move through.
Yes.
Not through, in.
In.
We hope
it goes
honest. Through. Right now it's just here.
You can see the wind. Why? Because of the rain. Just that education, you know, all those observations.
I tell you, huh? Are we going to come out with the best of Craig James at the end of the season? Because I've learned a lot over the course of the season.
Does that mean you never contemplate some of the things coming out of my brain?
I try just to move on as quickly as I can. What do you say they just let him play with the chains tangled? You
Holy
need 9 7/8 yards for first down.
As long as it goes both ways.
Right, it's fair for both teams. Apparently they have that problem solved. It'll be first down and 10 for UAB. Four wide receivers into the game. And if it's possible, it's raining harder right now than it has at any time. A handoff straight ahead to White. A lot of guys running around, but it was just a straight ahead run. And he ran into John Simmons. A gain of a yard for White.
Having fun.
So you want to be a cheerleader. Well, now we know why there are so few people here, because apparently they watched the local news and saw this weather forecast. A very disappointing crowd when it started. You can understand why a few folks might not want to come out in this. Plus the opportunity to watch Craig James comfort of your home in spectacular HD. Are we on an HD tonight? Norris Drinkard, I hope so. I mean, really, just sure
you can
handsome
see it.
Fella, and even that much better looking in spectacular HD.
You know what? I thought it was the water that was getting deep in here.
And we're fortunate. I want to knock on wood as I say that. But right now the wind is not blowing in our direction, or we're in big trouble. Not a lot of fun for our camera crew. Trying to keep those lenses dry and spotless.
Last time UAB was third and long, they ran the football. Big run. See what they do this time.
They really haven't tried to throw it since the monsoon happened. You would expect that South Florida might be ready for that now, and they were. White stopped after a short gain. This really cuts into what UAB likes to do. They can run the football, but they've also been outstanding in the long passing game, which seems very difficult to execute under these conditions.
And Watson Brown said, we're clearly not a 3 yard, 4 yard, 5 yard gain type of offense. We're a big play offense. And if you take that away from us, it changes our whole dynamic.
Jackie Chambers will try to find the ball. Among the raindrops is Parker Mullins punts. Sophomore from Starkville, Mississippi. Has it go off the side of his foot and out of bounds. A very short punt into the breeze. They will mark it at the 26-yard line, a 19-yard punt. Well, the rain continues to come down about as heavily as it can. Sean McDonough with Craig James, and this really does appear to change the strategy of the game.
Well, it definitely does. It's a running game now. Who holds onto the football? Who can break some tackles and make the big plays? Andre Hall has to do it for South Florida. A little nugget for you, my friend. South Florida 36-7 when scoring first. Thought I'd give you something good there.
So I thought you were going to say when it rains like at 4 inches an hour or something like that.
I hadn't found that one yet.
Area, they're used to some tropical rain. Actually, it's slowing down at the moment. Flag down as Hall goes right up the middle. Out to the 30 for a gain of 5 if it stands. A flag thrown by the linesman right as the ball was being snapped. Here's Jim Leavitt, the very soggy head coach.
Legal formation on the 6 on the line of scrimmage. 5 yards, repeat first down.
This might have been the night for the windbreaker jacket instead of the sweatshirt. That's a little soggy looking.
He picked up a few pounds. No excuse though for the offensive. You know, if it's a holding, you're getting beat, that's one thing. You know, but false start in a formation, illegal formation, and they simplified the offense for Julemus so that he's a little bit more comfortable with things. You got to understand what you're doing.
On first and 15, Hall again. He delivered a blow to the defense and got back to 5 yards. They lost to the penalty. Well, Well, the rain has slowed down considerably, and I'm sure among the happiest here is Heather Cox.
It's still falling, but certainly not as heavy. Now, some adjustments that have been made on the sidelines for the game personnel. Typically four footballs on each side. They have now gone to eight, so we're playing with a total of 16 footballs. Instead of eight, they've got them in canvas bags with towels around them in an effort to keep them as dry as possible. Make this running game and passing game as easy as can be in these conditions, guys.
All right, Heather, thank you very much. Hall, boy, is he a powerful runner at 5'10", 205. He's dragging people along for the ride, a gain of nine, and finally, Zach Woodfin got him down. We're at historic Legion Field in Birmingham, Alabama, home of the UAB Blazers. It's their home exclusively now. The University of Alabama used to play some games here. They are doing that no longer. Sean McDonough with Craig James and Heather Cox. Delighted to have you with us on the seventh of 19 consecutive days of college football on ESPN Family of Networks. Hall up to 96 yards rushing with 10 minutes to go in the half. They change it up and give it to Clinton Crossley. He's the second all-time leading rusher in the history of their program, the eight-year history. Got a first down with that short run.
Yeah, and plenty of push here. Nobody comes clean and free into the backfield. And as long as the offensive line continues to identify, they're okay. They're not blowing UAB off the ball, but they're finding their man. They're occupying.
Crossley with 1,524 career rushing yards behind only Raphael Williams, 729 yards behind. Not likely to catch the all-time leading rusher of the Bulls. On first and 10, the rain just about over. It's Crossley again. He's already graduated from the University of South Florida, graduated in August with a degree in interdisciplinary social sciences.
Don't know that one.
No.
But if you graduate, I don't get that. If you graduated, then how is Booby still around here? That's his nickname.
5 years of eligibility.
But he graduated.
But you can take your graduate classes, work toward another degree.
So he's in graduate school.
Or still in the university just pursuing another degree. Crossley out to the 45-yard line. Maybe they just let him do it over again. All right, you took the classes. Take them over.
Yeah, plausible.
Reinforced, because I'm sure, like me, you know, most of what you took in college, you forgot, you know, 30 seconds after you walked out of the classroom.
Hey, my kids are, when they bring their homework home, unless it's history, I got to go back and learn
history.
It again.
I have found that my geology class is not really
paying off
that
in life.
Valuable.
Yeah. Other than the rockhead you got.
Well, that stadium in Anaheim, you know, is that igneous rock out there in center field. Third down and two. They get the first down and go into UAB territory. A gain of seven for Crossley. Jermaine McElveen made the tackle. Jim Leavitt likes the way this one is going. His team is scuffled. They're trying to avoid the longest losing streak in the history of the program. They come in having lost three in a row to Southern Miss, Army, and Louisville. Last time out 12 days ago, they lost 41-9 at Louisville. Never lost four in a row, either as a 1AA team or now in Division 1A. This is a broken play, and Joe Miss goes down back in his own territory, a loss of 2.5 or 3. Larry McSwain, the former walk-on, made the tackle.
Just negative plays. South Florida, you saw the graphic how they're leading and rushing in this ball game. The running back, it looked like a stretch, a zone stretch going to the right side, and the running back went the wrong way. He was thinking counter. Was nothing counter about that.
Probably thinking about all those extra classes he's taking now that he's graduated, had his head in the books, not in the playbook.
Now, when he was a freshman, he wouldn't have made that mistake. He didn't have all that intelligence upstairs.
On second and long, one-on-one coverage, and it is incomplete through the hands of Johnny Payton. Might have been batted away by Bobby Keys, but looked like Payton had a chance to catch that one and could not. Jewel missed now just 2 out of 6 passing for 11 yards.
And you know, just at the end, it's almost like Keys gets his hand on it. It just went right through him. You know, and in the wet football like that, you've got to create a basket. You've got to use your body. That's a big play. They can't afford to give those up.
And Payton knows it. He originally committed to Pittsburgh and then elected to come to USF. Crossley trying to get outside, and he cannot. Stopped after a short game to the 50-yard line. He picked up a couple, but it's third and now a fourth and long, and they'll punt. Julius Wainwright, Nigel Eldridge made the tackle. We have Eldridge now for 7 tackles here in the first half. So a punt for Brandon Baker, punting for the first time tonight with the wind. Reggie Lindsay back at the 10-yard line.
Nice.
Up into that breeze. And out of bounds along the near sideline. Spotted. Perhaps when we come back. No, they spotted at the 18 back after this. Certainly did not see the sunset tonight here in Birmingham. The rain is back in earnest. Most of the fans well prepared. It's never too wet to go get yourself a hot dog, as Craig James proves every
I'm
week.
I'm telling you. Man, we had a couple of UConn games. Now, that place, they'll serve you a dog with some sauerkraut, mustard, ketchup.
They served you about 4 dogs.
Absolutely. Halftime was good.
On first and 10, the handoff by Hackney. Burks reversed his field. And there's a hard-earned run out to the 23-yard line. He gained 5. Mike Jenkins and Javen Kamen made the tackle. Jenkins, a freshman from Bradenton, Florida, honed his skills as a defensive back working on the summers in Bradenton, covering Peter Warwick.
Wow. You know, the beauty of what South Florida has going for them as a school, new facilities, a lot of good things. You know, Big East coming on board. But they've got that recruiting bed, that hotbed down there in South Florida. If the Big Three doesn't get one and you're not quite good enough to play there, hey, man, South Florida's got a great story for you.
Yeah, they hope to make it the Big Four in the state of Florida. Jim Leavitt believes the move to the Big East will really help them do that. They're already seeing an upgrade in their recruiting because of the pending move to the Big East next year and the automatic BCS bid that comes with a championship in the Big East. They've been successful in Division 1A as an independent, and then last season 7-4 in their first year in Conference USA. We said they've been bowl eligible, they've just not been picked. And this year, 2-4, they're going to have to do a lot of work to get to the winning record needed to be bowl eligible. Full house backfield. And they pick up the first down. White tackled by Kamen at the 31-yard line. First and 10, UAB with 4:50 to go. UAB will remain here in Conference USA under the new alignment. Later on, we'll show you what this league will look like next year.
You know what UAB is doing right here, setting up.
The deep ball.
The deep one.
A little play action pass.
Rain's let up a little bit here. Running game's working for them. 4 plays in a row trying to pound at you. Roddy White, he's got his extra long cleats on. Watch out. There he is.
Looks taller with those extra long cleats on. They're going for him, and he is open, and it's just a yard too long. Nice call, Craig. Mike Jenkins had the coverage, but White, as has been the case tonight, was behind the defense.
Yeah, just a little bit off, and, you know, it's one of those throws where, you know, maybe he can't quite run and get down there as quick as he wants, a little slow out of the start, but you cannot go to sleep in the secondary with Roddy White over there. And you got to think, man, you got to have a real mind for the game of what they're working on over there in the secondary. You got to say, hey, look, is this team setting me up? We know they like the big play, been running a bunch. Watch out.
Boy, White has just made, in the words of Watson Brown, unbelievable improvement every year. He's a long strider, not blazing speed, but those long strides he uses to get behind the defense. Burks tripped up. You saw the flags thrown. A lot of movement along the line of scrimmage, and this is going to be offsides against South Florida.
offside on the defense. Number 59, 5 yards, Pete second down.
Jim Leavitt not very happy. Ben Moffitt, the guilty party. Jim Leavitt, two-sport athlete in Missouri, played football and baseball. Here's what Conference USA will look like next year. USF will be departing along with Cincinnati and Louisville. Two divisions, and Watson Brown was saying, boy, we're in a tough division in the East. Southern Miss, a perennial power in this conference, part of their division. And the newcomer Marshall, which we all know how productive they've been throughout the recent years. They'll be in that division as well. Burks, a strong run to the 43. That's a 21-yard run for Burks. In the West, your alma mater, SMU, will join the league. And Coach Watson Brown was saying, you know, this will be good for schools like SMU because a lot of those traditional rivalries from the old days of the Southwest Conference, you get a lot of teams playing local rivals now rather than going all over the world.
Nobody's familiar with each other. You know, it's a regional flair, and they're going to understand when they're recruiting and they're telling the kid, hey, we'll have a regular series with Houston Rice, Tulane, UTEP.
As an SMU product, are you happy about their arrival in Conference USA?
With that hat on as an SMU alum, absolutely. Best thing that could have happened to SMU.
Javen Kamen knocked Burks out of bounds. There is another flag on the play.
You saw me circle UTEP. I mean, how about UTEP? Top 25 program.
First year under Mike Price. What a remarkable sequence of events in his life.
Offside. On the defense. Number 56. The penalty's declined. Down.
Jim Leavitt has to wonder what in the heck is going on over there.
And these are the kind of penalties. Lining up offside, jumping offside. That'll really drive you crazy, especially, you know, he's been talking to his team over and over again about the penalties. It's been a problem all year. And again tonight.
You know, I bet Heather could listen down there to this hard snap count to see if Hackney's drawn him off audibly.
On second and short, White banged out of bounds, but a nice run. It looked like they had him bottled up behind the line of scrimmage. Instead, he ran for five to the 29 and a first down. Javen Kamen with a sixth tackle. That's not good when your safety is six tackles. He's a senior from Port Charlotte, the leading tackler for the season. That was 65.
You know, and again, a reminder, there's a big weight advantage for UAB's offensive line. And you see that at 313 pounds down here, you watch the white jerseys on defense, they're walking back to the huddle slower, right? So there's good and bad to this. If they turn into a ball control, pound you offense tonight, they're going to wear out South Florida's defense.
You would think now with the rain just about gone, again, the wind died down, the field holding up pretty well, they could throw it. They do. Hackney, incomplete. Threw it over the head of the tight end, Cedric Hampton, who had stopped. Hackney thought he was going to continue toward the end zone. Royal with some pressure. And it'll be second down and 10.
Yeah, that pressure is going to come from his backside, left side of your screen. And the pressure's there. The timing's not on. This weather definitely has disrupted Hackney, his ability to throw. You know, the timing, the rhythm is not there.
He started out 4 for 5 and is 0 for his last 4.
Ever since the flood.
The Locusts. A little bit of everything there for a while. Back to the run. White somehow got through all that traffic into the end zone for a touchdown. 29 yards. Second touchdown run of the ball game. Six of the season for White. The first one was a 2-yarder. This looked like it might be a 2-yard gain, and then somehow he escaped.
It just bottled up, and what happened was the corner came in from South Florida, number 12, and he just overran the cutback lane. They had him bottled up, never got to him in the backfield.
There's Nick Hayes now, who missed his first extra point try of the night. And that one's up and good. Coach Brown says they're not really a grounded out ball control type offense, but they were on that drive, and White capped it. The 82-yard drive, all the work done on the ground in the last 29 yards from Corey White.
Watch the safety, and this is called gap responsibility. Cameron, watch out when he gets up in there. He needs to be there, right there. Whoa, he has overrun his responsibility. He has to see where the running back is thinking. He's got to fill that gap backside, and that's just the difference between experience. It's the difference between cohesiveness.
In there. Exuberance,
yes.
Something.
Something I was looking for. It lost it in Webster's.
High and short kickoff. You got to get the dartboard out here or you leave that at your house? Show us which coin you use.
Well, I get that double-sided one out. You know what I do? Like, I'll be honest right now. As an AP voter with Utah, I've had Utah at number 10. I will not put Utah any higher than 10.
Why?
Because I feel like that a Tennessee, a Georgia, a once-beaten major conference team has to deal with more challenges than what you're dealing with from a Utah. Utah's a good football team, and I'm not saying Utah could not excel if they were in the Big 12. They might even win the Big 12, but they're not being challenged with it.
Here's Hall. Fighting for yardage and all the way to the 39-yard line. Tackled by Julius Wainwright. Now, wait a minute. If I'm not mistaken, Utah beat Texas A&M.
Right, good team.
Which has turned out to have a very good season.
Right.
They beat North Carolina, which just beat Miami. Mm. They hammered North Carolina. They're legit.
I'm not saying they're not legit, but fellas back in the studio, I'm just saying, and you have to agree with me back there, is the fact that they're not having to do it week in and week out. You know what? We saw Miami lose to North Carolina. They had to go play a team they weren't supposed to lose to. And if you've got to do that week in and week out, the chances are you're going to get nicked along the way.
Craig, you are absolutely
right.
They have
to be in the top six in the BCS to ensure themselves a spot in the BCS bowl games. And from what we understand, it's quite possible, even if they win out, that one or two of these one-loss teams behind them could leap over them.
They could. And you see what the coaches and the AP polls are saying right now. They're at 7-8 with Utah. I think they're sending a message. We don't believe they should be six because that guarantees them a spot in there.
Second down and 9. Hall's up over 100 yards rushing now. Joel miss a rear deep throw, and it is caught. Touchdown, USF. Jackie Chambers, a 38-yard touchdown reception. He beat Julius Wainwright. And South Florida answers the Blazers' touchdown with one of their own. First career touchdown for the true freshman, Jackie Chambers.
The beneficiary, Chambers, there, play action. Andre Hall running the football, having some success on the ground. They're getting the single coverage on the outside. We saw them drop a potential touchdown the last series.
Fifth touchdown pass of the season for Julmus. And Santiago Gramatica adds the extra point. 4 plays, 68 yards. It took just 1:18 for the touchdown. Back to a 3-point game, 13-10 UAB nearing halftime. Well, a thrill for Jackie Chambers, the true freshman out of Miami's Edison High School, where his first team All-State Class 5A last year. His first career college touchdown reception, a 38-yarder. First touchdown of the night for Jim Leavitt's Bulls. They're back within 3. Upset-minded here in Birmingham tonight against the favored Blazers. Justin Geisler kicks off for South Florida. Jason Southall and Reggie Lindsay back for the kickoff with the breeze. Southall's going to try it. And a good decision. There is a flag down. There are 2 flags down. Southall's down to the 25.
The old block in the back.
Thank you. Well, the good folks, by the way, in the state of Utah, I just want them to know that was Craig James. Send all your mail and your emails on to Sean McDonough.
Back, number 55 on the return team. Half the distance to the goal, first down.
Well, there's the report on the Utes. They stay in that top six position. They're guaranteed a spot in the BCS. The question is, if they do finish in the top six, do they deserve it? If they go undefeated with their schedule, would they be more deserving than, say, a 10-1 Michigan, a one-loss Texas?
Tennessee, Georgia, Cal. I'm not saying that Utah isn't a worthy football team, and that they could not, if given the chance, win the SEC, the Big Ten, Big 12, but they're not. You can't make it apples and apples. In the system we're living within today, you have to make some kind of guess as to how they would be. And I'm just not. I'm going to keep them at 10.
Well, I think they're the best team, most talented team of these non-BCS schools we've seen in recent years make a little run like this. The Boise States, the TCUs, I think they are the best team.
I agree with you there. I tell you who I'd like to see them play, Louisville.
Louisville will be another one in that conversation.
Boy.
Of course, their situation would be a lot different if they had finished the job at Miami. Here's Burks again on second down, reversing his field, trying to outrun the defense, and he cannot. Well defended by Ben Moffitt. If USF should use a timeout here, and they will. The chance to force a punt into a stiff wind that has died down a little bit with the diminishing rain. Another short pass.
I would like to be referred to.
Norris Drinkard out of bounds at the 32-yard line with 35 seconds to go in the half.
I want to clarify one thing. I did not say that Utah would win the SEC or the Big 12. I said that given that chance, who's to say they couldn't? But we don't know what they would do because right now they're not playing it. You geniuses back there in Bristol. I love you, boys.
Yeah, that's not what you were saying off the air, but that's okay. Second down and three. After South Florida's using timeouts to try to get the ball back, now it looks like UAB getting a little greedy here. Pass incomplete. Devin Davis put the pressure on Darrell Hackney. Two timeouts left for UAB. 29 seconds left. And a third down and three.
South Florida has to have a lot of confidence going in at halftime. The big play strike offensively was good for them. I think they expected UAB to score. If you'd asked South Florida and Jim Leavitt at halftime if they'd only scored 13, would you be happy? And he'd have probably said, yeah, probably.
A shovel pass inside to Corey White. He does not get the first down. Just wait till whatever the results are, just tell us.
Well, don't you think that Reese was trying to do a little exit poll with us up here?
Yeah. Parker Mullins the punt. Jackie Chambers, the freshman, manages to stay on his feet. There's a flag down. Chambers didn't lose anybody with the spin move, and he's down at the 41-yard line. There's 7 seconds to go in the half. Darius Taylor made the tackle on special teams from the University of Alabama at Birmingham.
During the return, blocking it back. On the return team, 10 yards from the spot of the foul, First down.
Just in case you're wondering, the referee Barry Anderson is not an intermittent talker. His microphone is not functioning correctly.
He's talented.
Every now and then, just a few words drop out.
There are two different places where this could have happened.
Right,
one on
there.
The far left side, and again right in front of him, and behind, and just kind of the little gentle pushes in the back twice.
Our exit polling would indicate most people thought it was on the first guy. We're not really sure. That's the end of the half. No, the penalty's still the problem for Jim Leavitt, but he's right in the football game. A little help from Mother Nature. 13-10 at the half. We're back in Birmingham, just about start of the second half. It's 13-10 UAB, despite the fact they were slightly outgained in the first half by South Florida. Sean McDonough with Craig James. What do you look for in the second half?
Well, I think, you know, right now you have to say South Florida, way to go running the football. Andre Hall, 126 yards, 9 yards per clip. They got to keep running the ball to keep it away from Roddy White on the other side. You know, Hackney will warm up eventually if you give him time. The weather, like you said, going out at half, really helped South Florida tremendously.
Let's get a report now from Heather Cox.
Well, I was able to talk to both coaches, and Watson Brown certainly admitted that the conditions derailed both offenses. He said he had to be much too conservative in his play calling because the ball was so heavy and so wet. Look for them to be a little bit more risky, a little bit more high-powered if it stays dry in the second half. Defensively, he said, we let a couple of fade routes get by. We've got to buckle down on that in the second half. Now, on the other side of the field, Coach Leavitt, he was happy. He was actually quite optimistic. He said, defensively, we've got to do a little bit better job adjusting to tackling. But other than that, we're in the hunt in this ball game, guys.
Yeah, I think if you told him, Craig, halftime he'd be down by 3, he'd take that, the way things have gone lately for both of these two teams.
And only given up 13 points to a pretty explosive UAB offense.
USF outgained them 197-188 in the first half. Justin Geisler kicks off for the South Florida Bulls. And Reggie Lindsay decided not to bring it out from the middle of the end zone. Let's check the KFC game track. Heavy rain through much of the first half, a big story, as Watson Brown said it certainly did limit his play selection. Both touchdowns for the Blazers scored by Corey White from 2 yards and 29 yards. They missed an extra point. And the TD for South Florida. On a long pass to Jackie Chambers, his first career touchdown, 38-yarder for the true freshman from Miami. Hackney throws, and it is caught for a first down. Nice catch by Norris Drinkard. He's out to the 43-yard line, a gain of 23 for Drinkard.
And you know what? They come out, and here, dry weather, there's that light football that Heather was talking about. And out of the backfield, split wide, giving a different look to that South Florida defense. So you know that Watson Brown and Pat Sultan, they want to get this offense cranked up through the air.
Hackney 8 for 14 for 92 yards now. Fifth in the nation in passing efficiency starting the night. Was on target early with the deep ball, then they had to get away from it because of the rain. He lost that up. There's White again. Roddy White inside the 35-yard line. And down at the 33. That's the fourth catch of the night for White, another 23-yard gain.
Well, Devin Davis, number 52, he comes in and gives a little bit of wood right here. Boom, right into it. And you know, when you're hitting 235, getting him to go back like that, you know that's some wood being delivered. And then Roddy White just keeps going for the football. And talked to an NFL scout at halftime. He's saying, hey, this guy might be a number one draft choice. That's how good Roddy White is.
Senior from Charleston, South Carolina. 137 career receptions. Mentioned Coach Brown talks about he just keeps improving. They're throwing to him in double coverage, and it's batted away. Good work in the secondary by Bruce Gibson. He had help from Danny Verpale, the freshman defensive back whose brother Kevin was a standout in their secondary last year and is now a graduate assistant coach at South Florida.
You know, and one of the things that UAB has been a little weak at this year is protecting the quarterback. A lot of pressure, a lot of hits have come on him because of the blitz. And in the secondary this time, like you said, Sean, really good job of the safety coming over to help to take away the inside leverage of White.
Four wide receivers now on second and 10. Hackney after the fake got hit as he throws, and it's incomplete. He took a shot in the back. Terrence Royal.
Hackney weighs 235 pounds. He may want to go put on some extra pads if he's going to stand there this long. He's going to get drilled again. Terrence Royal came in, gave him some love that time.
Well, you mentioned the sacks, 23 of them against Hackney entering tonight's action, but eight of those were against Florida State.
That's right.
And they do get blitzed a lot. When you get blitzed, you're going to get sacked.
But the reason they're doing that, they're getting the blitz because they're trying to get him off of rhythm. Hackney out of rhythm, throwing the ball. Otherwise, Roddy White, that's pitch and catch.
Good job by this defense. They're setting up a screen. Their flag's down. Burks has a first down, it appears, depending on the spot. Sydney Simpson made the tackle. There is a flag down, two flags down, in fact, at the line of scrimmage. Sure, they gave Burks the spot for the first down either. It would be very close if the penalty doesn't wipe out the play. And now an official's timeout. Apparently they're going to measure, but what about the flags?
There are two yellows down there.
Yeah, there were flags on each side of the field.
Yeah. So it's going to be against South Florida, and I'm sure that Watson Brown's wanting to know what, if he's got a first down, he'd decline it, right? It's the only rational thought.
If he doesn't have it, it's going to be by inches, though. Well, that takes away the decision. We'll turn down the penalty, says Watson Brown.
Offsides. Number 45 on the defense. The penalty is declined. First down.
John Simmons was offside. Would have been the sixth penalty of the night against South Florida. So an impressive opening drive to the half for the UAB Blazers. Trying to add to a three-point lead. The opening possession of the second half. First and 10 at the 23-yard line of South Florida. Burks. Belted down by Steven Nicholas. Fifth tackle of the night for Nicholas. Here's Heather.
Sean and Craig, you guys were talking about Darrell Hackney and the amount of times he's gotten hit tonight. This is actually his first season so far going without an injury. And he told me, I'm tired of everybody asking me if I'm healthy and if I'm injured. And he said, the reason I'm not, I've changed the way I play. Last year, I took unnecessary hits. This year, the focus on me and the coaches, they're telling me to focus on getting on the ground, getting out of bounds. But Craig, my question is this, do you think he's doing enough of that and not taking too many risks out there?
Tonight, Heather, he's doing the opposite of that. He's taking a lot of unnecessary hits. He's going to have to know when the journey is over.
Threw that one up for grabs. Good defense against Reggie Lindsay by Trey Williams. Freshman from Plant City, Florida. Designing an interception that he might have taken the length of the field down that far sideline had he been able to get in front of Reggie Lindsay. He's already had an interception return for a touchdown. That is the only interception this season for South Florida. Ball State tied with them with one interception each, fewest in Division 1A football. This came against Tennessee Tech in their first game of the year, so they're about due for a pick.
Yeah.
Five wide receivers now on third down. Hackney throws, it is caught, and with the forward progress, it'll be a first down. Roddy White, the big target. Ball ripped away, but the whistles had already stopped the play. Patrick St. Louis came away with the ball. And they're going to mark the ball inside the 12-yard line. And it'll be first and 10 for the University of Alabama at Birmingham.
I'm not sure if everybody picked up on the audio there, but if you could listen to it, you heard all the UAB sidelines hollering, hey, y'all better hit the weights. You better go get on the weights, because they couldn't get White down. A little bit of that love talk going on the football field. But you notice who he locked into.
Back.
Yeah, you saw who he locked in on, right? Mm-hmm. Roddy White. There's a lot of confidence from Darrell Hackney throwing the ball to White for good reason. And the guy's coming back. He's finding the football, and he's going to catch it.
5 for 75 now, and you wonder where he'd be had it not been for the torrential rain that took him out of the football game for a while. Hackney with a blitz coming, going for White. He was shoved out of bounds, and flags are thrown. He was just pushed across the sideline as they were trying to throw the fade. Bruce Gibson, the guilty party. Not catchable, says Jim Leavitt.
Pass interference on the defense. Number 19, first down, 3 yard line.
And Jim Leavitt was screaming that the ball was uncatchable, but clearly Gibson, look at him, just continue to push and push and get him out of bounds. And as aggressive as the push was is why the benefit of the doubt went to the receiver.
And a little chatter as well. Roddy White admits that he's a little bit talkative. He says he's talkative, but he doesn't like to cross the line. He thinks some of those guys like T.O. in the NFL go too far.
You think?
It's just his theory, I guess. I'm not sure anybody would agree with that. There's White sticking the ball out, trying for his third touchdown of the night, but his knees were down before the lunge. Matter of fact, Roddy White, like some of those guys in the NFL, is self-confident. He had something written on his padding earlier in the year during practice and said, very talented. And Coach Watson Brown said, yeah, I don't mind that, but that padding, that lettering will not make it onto the game field.
And that's good. That's good. See if he was down before the ball crossed.
Yes.
He's down. Clearly he's down. And he has to be careful with that, throwing that football out before you get across.
White again. Touchdown, his third of the night. Corey White from 1 yard out. His touchdown runs of 2:29 and 1. And UAB has a 19-10 lead, a very impressive opening drive. 10 plays, 80 yards to begin the second half. And there's an injured player in the end zone. South Florida player. Curtis Chance, freshman from St. Petersburg, Florida. Looks like his left ankle. They've had a lot of injuries this year. I mentioned the youth, and Jim Leavitt thinks that they have a great freshman class. They played 17 freshmen last week against Louisville. But you have youth and inexperience and then a lot of injuries. And you add to that with penalties and turnovers. It all has the earmarks of a disappointing year, which this has been so far for USF. 2-4 overall, 1-3 in conference. And really that loss to Army, Craig. Admittedly, they had already ended their long losing streak with a win over Cincinnati at Bobby Ross's team. But they led by 2 touchdowns, did USF, at home against Army on homecoming, blew it. And that's the kind of loss that can send a team into a spiral. They're still trying to get out of that downward spiral.
And in between that and the youth really is what gets you going there. You have the injury bug hit you and the confidence starts to get a little bit rattled. That's why it was important for them to start out the first half like they did tonight in a positive way.
The extra point up and good by Nick Hayes. And it's back to a 10-point lead for the second time tonight for the Blazers. Early in the third quarter, UAB 20 and USF 10. Corey White had 4 rushing touchdowns in the first 7 games of this season. He's had 3 tonight, a career high for the sophomore from Birmingham. He has all 3 touchdowns for UAB. And Nick Hayes kicks off short down to the 19-yard line to J.B. Garris. And he's forced across the sideline at the 34-yard line. A 15-yard return for Garris. Another of those freshmen for Coach Leavitt. There are the problems, the penalties and turnovers. They're last in the conference, 113th in the nation in penalty yardage. Last in the conference in turnover margin, they're -9. UAB had those 2 problems last year. It's really the biggest reason why they missed a bowl game at 5-7. They committed 28 turnovers last year, but they've really turned that around. Cut down on the flags. Plus 7 in turnover margin. Neither team has turned it over tonight. Given how hard it rained for a while, there's a credit to both squads. Hall, after the big first half, they were ready for him on his first carry of the second half. A gain of a yard out to the 35. And another injured player on the field for South Florida. Looks like John Miller. They've had some injuries to that offensive line.
And Miller's been playing well. I mean, that left guard's pulled tonight and had some nice job, nice big blocks. Left guard right over here, you see where he comes, and he's going to pull up into the hole, and they've been following him several times tonight. You see him get up in the, kind of get hit from behind. But Leavitt, that's the last thing he needs to happen is to lose.
Looks like he's all right. Junior from Belgrade, Florida. Part-time starter. Play action pass. Jewel missed going deep. For Payton, jump ball, and Payton came down with it. At the 18-yard line of UAB, he won the battle with Bobby Keys. And that's a demonstration of why Payton was a very highly recruited player. Terrific catch against Keys for a 47-yard gain, and Keys is injured.
You remember the last time Payton went down the field on the right side first half, Sean? He dropped one. Keys almost deflected it, but he didn't quite come up with it on this one here. And it's the old tip drill. And a big play, big strike like that in this particular series was critical for South Florida's offense.
Keys injured, so that's the reason for the delay. Now they're moving him toward the sideline. Looked like he might have just had the wind knocked out of him.
And he's getting that single coverage out there because of the success that Andre Hall has had on the ground, obviously. They've got to stop
that. That was definitely a catch, by the way. By the time he got possession of it, he was battling Keys for it as they went over the sideline.
You know what? Now that they're getting ready to snap the football, yes, I do think it was a catch.
No replay in Conference USA for use by the officials. Jackie Chambers, the freshman. You know, they're trying to win football games this year, obviously, Craig, but great experience for these freshmen. We keep talking about this guy's a freshman, that guy's a freshman. Next year they go to the Big East. There's a lot of people believe the South Florida program, because of their location, proximity to great high school talent, is a sleeping giant, particularly in the Big East. They could go into that league right away and have a chance.
Absolutely. I think the upside for South Florida is as big as any school in America. And the conference run they're getting ready to make with all that talent to recruit down in Florida, everybody down there knows and understands the Big East.
Jewel missed in the back of the end zone too high. Threw it where he had to avoid risking an interception. Jackie Chambers was covered by Will Evans. There's what the Big East will look like next year. Of course, Miami and Virginia Tech have already departed. Boston College leaves after this season. Louisville, Cincinnati, and South Florida arrive from Conference USA.
Rutgers is coming around. Rutgers has some good talent.
Connecticut clearly on the rise. West Virginia seems to be the class of the league this year. Third down and 8 from the 16-yard line. And open low throw, it's caught right along that yellow first down line by Allenson Sheffield. The senior from Miami thinks he has the first down. And no signal yet from the officials. Yes, it is a first down, first and goal for the South Florida Bulls.
And plenty of time for Jewel Miss to throw the football. Beautiful job of going beyond the first down marker. You know, really, really a nice job of just discipline on his route. Chambers on the previous pattern over to that post corner that he ran, I thought he broke off his route. That was a nice throw on that one.
Five wide receivers, shotgun for Julmas. He runs through it, and a good tackle at the 6-yard line Looked like he had a lane, but Jermaine McElveen made that lane disappear in a hurry.
Long arms, reach out and grab, reach out and touch someone. That was a good call. Had the corner blitz coming from the left side. Four rushers up the front. Give him something to think about now on defense. Because we haven't seen Jewel Miss run in this game.
They've been a spread offense over the years, trying to go to more of a traditional offense. They think that's the approach they need to be successful in the Big East. Jewel Miss forced to pull it down. Delivers a stiff arm. Ooh. Touchdown, and then he took a hit in the end zone. Will Evans laid the wood to Jewel Miss, and he's lucky there wasn't a flag. If that had been a half a step deeper into the end zone, he probably would have been flagged. 6-yard touchdown run, and they're right back within the field goal if they can add the extra point.
You know what? You've got to now a whole new dimension thinking on defense. You have to recognize and be aware, linebacker level especially, that he may pull it down and run the football.
That hit appeared to affect Jewel Miss as he went to the sideline. His fifth rushing TD of the year. Santiago Gramatica, the brother of Martin and Bill Gramatica, with the extra point. And the South Florida Bulls continue to hang right in there. 20-17. Ooh. More than 9.5 to go in the third. Well, there aren't many here, but those who are having a good time and enjoying a very good football game. UAB. Vice is led by 10, the lead back down to 3. Justin Geisler kicks off for the Bulls. Another good kick with the win. No chance for Jason Southall to run it out. Falco.
Yeah. Oh, yes.
First and 10, UAB. Touchdown drive led by Hackney on their first possession of this half. Each team has scored on its first possession, as was the case in the first half. Hackney, after a lot of faking, puts it up for grabs, and a great move back to the ball by White, but he couldn't make the catch. Evan Davis put the heat on Hackney. Mike Jenkins looked like he was in excellent position for an interception. White almost made another terrific catch.
But you could see, Sean, why, you know, South Florida's in position to make an interception. That ball's thrown up there, and that should have been intercepted. But Roddy White goes, and he makes a move on the ball, and the defensive back just kind of sits back there and waits on it to get there. Hall didn't, you know, or Jenkins didn't make the move to go get it.
White had 121 yards receiving in their win at South Florida last year. South Florida's ready for that play now. They've tried it a few times. Have the Blazers and Norris Brinkert stopped immediately by Terrence Royal, the junior from Tampa.
Oh, yeah. Choo-choo. You know South Florida has to feel pretty good about their chances right now. Not necessarily to win the game, but they're in the game. And I'm not so certain that they felt like coming in here with the injuries and the inconsistencies that they've had and the youth against this high-powered offense, that they may have that kind of chance.
What do you mean, Burns?
Is he running for something? What was that? Flag down. I thought, thankfully, the political season was over. Now, you're saying they're happy to be in the game, but they don't think they can win the game? Is that what I took out of that? What was that all about?
I was trying to baffle you with some great BS.
You did. You did.
They're not just happy to be here.
Hold it. Number 69 on the offense. Goes decline. Fourth down.
That was Quinn Harris, the 330-pound guard from Cortland, Alabama. As we said earlier, was the biggest, most pleasant surprise on their team, according to Watson Brown and the offensive coordinator, Pat Sullivan. It's a punt. It'll be the fourth punt of the night for Parker Mullins. He's averaged 39 per punt. That includes a 62-yarder. Boom into the end zone with the wind going the other way in the first half. Jackie Chambers back for the kick.
Easy. Don't hold him.
It's returnable. Nobody near Chambers if he makes the catch. And a good tackle in the open field. After an 11-yard return, Darius Taylor made the tackle. Here's Heather Cox.
Well, Sean, for South Florida's Bruce Gibson, we've seen his versatility. He started at corner, then went to wide receiver, then to linebacker, now back to corner. Now his focus that's needed to make those moves even more impressive, knowing that just in September, during the hurricanes that slammed Florida, Bruce's 21-year-old stepbrother, Deltron Gamila, drowned while saving a family from a rip current. Now, he was in Daytona Beach taking shelter because he was displaced from his home during those hurricanes. And then after that, Gibson's stepmom, Kimberly, is now recovering from a heart attack that she sustained while learning of her son's death. And Bruce has dedicated the TCU win to his brother, the win right after that death. And he's also wearing a shirt under his pads with a picture of Deltron on the front of it. Said he'll wear it for the remainder of the season. And, guys, just an impressive story from a young man.
Tremendous adversity he's had to deal with during this season. He was a pallbearer at his stepbrother's funeral, as was Jabin Kamen, who was also a good friend of Dell. Shamar Abrams made the tackle. It'll be third down and short for the Bulls.
You notice how USF South Florida is going. The tempo has picked up tremendously here. You see the lineman, John Miller, by the way, 61 left guard, back in the game, which is good news for that offensive line. But they are all making a concerted effort to pick it up.
Third down and two. Nifty fake by Joel Mist that helped Hall get the first down. Down to the 31-yard line, Zach Woodfin. They had the tackle. They've said that a lot here over the years. He's the all-time leading tackler in the history of the program. Has set the school record for tackles in a season in each of the last two seasons.
Yeah, look at the discipline that fell apart on the containment on the bout side by him. You know, that's not a trademark of how he usually plays the ball. Woodfin usually is around there and stays home.
All for nothing that time, perhaps a yard. Heather told us the story of Bruce Gibson. A tremendous tragedy in his family. And these hurricanes have really been disruptive to the USF program throughout this fall. They had to reschedule their game at the beginning of the year against Pittsburgh to the end of the season. They couldn't fly back right away after their big overtime win at TCU because hurricanes were lingering in the Tampa Bay area, closed down the airports in Tampa and Orlando. Practices disrupted, players dealing with all the anxiety of hurricanes in their hometowns. Travis Lipp, the intended receiver. Brandon Register broke it up. So they've had a lot of adversity to deal with in this program this year.
And the fact that they have to play Pitt at the end of the year is not good, because Pitt was reeling, trying to put it together at the early part of the season. Now
they really struggled at the Bulls to beat Tennessee Tech in their opener. And Jim Leavitt said, probably a good thing we didn't play Pittsburgh today, because we might have struggled against a better team.
Maybe, but Pittsburgh's got Palco at quarterback, who I think is pretty darn good, and he's going to get better every game they play.
And he likes you, too.
Does he?
Well, he does now. Okay. After you said something that nice about him on national TV, he has to like you. Sheffield, the intended receiver, the pass a little bit too far in front of him. Dominic Cosper had the coverage. So now a field goal try for Gramatica, 47 yards from the right hash mark. With the breeze at his back, he's connected from 29 tonight. His 37th career field goal to set the school record. 47 would match his career long, or as long of a season, I should say, and it's no good. Wide left. He hooked it, and it's still a 3-point lead for UAB, more than midway through the third quarter. Sparse but energetic crowd here at Legion Field in Birmingham. Gotten to remove the rain jackets at least for the moment. We're all thankful for that. The rain has moved away. 6:43 left in the third quarter. And a 3-point lead for UAB. They take over after the missed field goal at the 30-yard line. Errol Hackney handed it off on an end around to Reggie Lindsay, and he's in trouble and dropped for a big loss back at the 19-yard line. They'll mark it at the 20 for a 10-yard loss. Devin Davis made the tackle, and USF was not at all fooled by the trick play.
It's almost like UAB is getting a little cute here and setting up and looking more for the big play than they are trying to put put that big offensive line to work, you know? That big weight advantage we talked about, coming out and drilling them in the mouth.
Watson Brown, the head coach, does call the plays with plenty of input from Pat Sullivan and the offensive staff.
We met Watson Brown's daughter in the elevator coming up tonight. She told us to be nice to her dad.
So you weren't going to rip him after that play
call?
No,
it worked. I didn't say anything bad about his play calling, really.
Oh, they lost 10 yards. Ordinarily, you'd be killing the guy. John Simmons deflected the pass. Watson Brown in his 10th season here. They've made the jump up. Program started in 1991. They were a Division III school. Then they went to 1AA in 93, up to 1A in 96. Watson doubles as the athletic director. Barry Alvarez at Wisconsin, the only other 1A football head coach, who's also the school's athletic director. John Robinson did it for a while at UNLV. Hackney in trouble and sacked. The second sack of the night for the Bulls. Tavarius Robinson and Leroy Selman Jr. in there on the sack.
And again, just no momentum offensively. Looking for the big strike, the big play, more than the setup for the big play. And hey, how lucky are they? That ball doesn't squirt out.
Pretty lucky.
That's what I'm talking about.
Second straight three and out for the UAB offense. Which came in averaging 36 points per game, 11th in the country. Taking their shots against the defense. It had really been horrendous lately, giving up 38 points per game are the Bulls in the last five. Designed running punt there from Parker Mullins. Has done that a few times tonight.
I did too, and I thought she was talking about the rain.
She was, in Memphis.
Which does not preclude it from raining in Louisville.
No, but she probably wouldn't be talking about the rain in Memphis if the game was in Louisville.
Unless they had to practice in the rain in Memphis.
So I'm going to guess that the card is wrong. Plus, it said Memphis there on the bottom of the graphic. Usually that's the home team.
Yeah.
So I'm guessing it's at Memphis.
That's that Syracuse degree coming through. You
there
want
you
perfection.
Newhouse School of Communications. Thank you for bringing that up. You just saved me my annual contribution now. In lieu of dollars, a little audio pop for the alma mater. A lot of cover it. 2004. After a short gain, second and eight. And Hall had trouble with it. He fell on it. Hall's family watching tonight. He has a lot of folks helping our ESPN2 ratings tonight. He's the seventh of nine children. His dad, Captain, is 83 years old. His dad battling diabetes and glaucoma. Partially blind. Hall was heading to Clemson out of high school. Didn't have the test score. So went to a couple of junior colleges. Wound up back close to home near his big family in the Tampa Bay area. But he was really impressed mostly by Coach Leavitt. So he talked to the players on the team. Was told that Coach Leavitt is an honest, trustworthy guy, the kind of guy you want to play for. And he has found that to be true. The pass was too high for Chambers. So now a punt on fourth down and 10. Been an interesting game. When one team goes down and scores, Craig, seems like the other goes right back and scores. When one gets stopped, the other one gets stopped.
And now the weather is working nicely for both schools, and you would think that UAB would be able to take advantage of it, but the quarterbacks are off on the throwing.
Brandon Baker, the putter. And he gets off a nice kick. Reggie Lindsay makes the fair catch. At the 13-yard line, 47-yard punt with no return.
I want to show you what Jewel Miss should have done. On the check down here to the flat, I want to show you Andre Hall. You're sitting there talking about him. You got a little leak. You've got an extremely talented back. I'll take that matchup on a short, efficient pass with him beating that linebacker who was going to go over and try to tackle him in the open.
Hall recruited out of the junior college by Oklahoma State, Nebraska, Texas A&M, among others, but came back home to play for the USF Bulls. He's made an immediate impact. You mentioned the 200-yard game against Army, the most yards rushing against the Division I-A team in the history of the USF program. Cedric Hampton, the tight end, with a tough run after the catch. He has a UAB first down out of the 34-yard line, a pickup of 21. Steven Nicholas finally got him down for his sixth tackle of the night.
And what a nice call by UAB this time here, because you've got eight men up in the box, really committed South Florida has to stopping the run. You'll see how they've got them up in here. And then
Hackney, a deep drop. As a man open, the throw is high for Lindsay. Caught by Coach Leavitt, and there's a flag thrown in the secondary. In the middle of the field, deeper down the field than where the ball wound up. Coach Leavitt, an excellent two-sport athlete, as we mentioned, at Missouri, football and baseball.
Hold it. On the defense. Number seven, 10 yards, automatic.
And the best part of that play for Jim was the catch that he made. The catch that the coach made.
Easy for you to say.
Yes.
Oh, tip drill. He's done that. Oh, he's taken off. Give him six. He's, you know what, though? You can tell he's one of them guys that has moxie, meaning that he had to run with courage because he was already exhaling on his second step. He ain't got no speed, coach.
Grew up in the Tampa Bay area in St. Petersburg. His family settled in the St. Pete area after they had bounced around for a while. His dad was an Air Force man. And as a young boy, Jim Leavitt lived in Taiwan, South Dakota, Massachusetts, and in Germany. Remember, the first football game he played in as a third grader was at the Ramstein Air Force Base in Germany. They moved to St. Petersburg, where his folks have lived ever since, nearly 40 years now. They've been married, as folks, for 56 years, Pierce and Lois, and they haven't missed a home game yet in the eight-year history of USF football. Jim was accepted into the Naval Academy, but said I was a little too wild for that. He went to Missouri instead. Dumped off to Lindsay, and he lost the football after he hit the ground, but they ruled him down by contact. Jim Leavitt thinks it's his ball. It is not. A 16-yard gain. Stephen Nicholas came up with it, but the officials say Lindsay was down prior to the fumble.
And Leavitt, just very frustrated. Jenkins, number two, has the flat. The corner, and for whatever reason, he had dropped back deep. Maybe he just didn't see the receiver jump out there, but Lindsay was clearly in the flat.
15 yards and in the run, first down.
And there's another penalty against the defense.
Personal foul against Terrence Royal, who got a critical penalty late in their game against, wow, is he fired up, against Southern Miss. There was a bad pass interference call that went against USF. Royal was so mad about it, he took his helmet off on the field. That got another 15-yard penalty, and that was a key play in their narrow loss to Southern Miss.
That's a love pat on the backside.
Eighth penalty for 66 yards. That continues to be a major problem for South Florida. Two tight ends in the game now. Hackney under pressure, lofts it up. It should be picked off. There's a flag down. Javen Kamen has the interception. But it looked like the receiver, Roddy White, got knocked down. And there might be a pass interference call here against South Florida. And Jim Leavitt looks like he's about ready to eat his headset. Officials again taking a long time chatting about it.
Pass interference on the defense. Number 12, 15 yards, first down.
Now, Roddy White, once he gets to the middle of the field, you'll see that he gets a little bit confused. There's some pushing. There's a bump. You can't call that inadvertent contact there.
No. He knocked him to the ground well downfield. It's actually number two, Mike Jenkins. The official Barry Anderson said 12, but it was number two. Well, they're right on their average. Ooh, and Terrence Royal and Coach Leavitt still getting after each other on the sideline. I don't think that's a love tap anymore, Craig.
And I don't think Jim Leavitt will put up with it either. You know, That's one of those deals there. You tell them to go and sit in the locker room because you're a distraction. Get a light, nice, long shower by yourself. And you've got 11 guys in that huddle and that whole sideline's fighting to do their thing. You just don't do that.
You mentioned he had the big penalty, inexcusable, even though it was a bad call, in my opinion, watching that tape of the Southern Miss game. He got a very costly penalty in that game. That hurt them, and he has another one on this drive. You can understand why Coach Leavitt will be upset. These guys keep committing penalties week after week after week that are killing them. Corey White for no gain. Back to the 9, perhaps the 8-yard line, and that's it. Craig Coble made the tackle. And you're right, Craig, if you're Jim Leavitt, I mean, after a while, you just got to say to that young man, you know what, take it to the locker room right now.
Yeah, go sit down.
We'll go win this game without you.
Yeah. It's too big a distraction.
And he's still mouthing off over there.
You know, as players, it's one thing to be fired up and have a passing comment to a coach. You know, you may, you know, slip and say how screwed up. But you don't stay after it.
Well, problem with the snap there. Like a half-hearted attempt to snap it, almost as if the center realized as he was snapping it, he had the wrong snap count. The double clutch snap by Matt Petusik.
On the offense, 5 yards, 2 seconds down.
That moves them back to the 14-yard line, second and goal from the 14. Watson Brown, the brother of Mack Brown, the coach at the University of Texas. Watson's been the head coach at Austin Peay, Cincinnati, Rice, and Vanderbilt. He has coached at some tough places to win. Blitz. Hackney got away. Throws to the end zone, batted down. Tended for Chavez in the back of the end zone. Sidney Simpson saved the touchdown.
Staying with it, staying with the play. A lot of pressure coming from number 40, Craig Coble. And then Hackney throws. It looks like he's there. And Simpson at the last second comes through and bats the ball out of the way.
Excellent play by the junior from Titusville, Florida. Third and goal from the 14. UAB leading by 3 with 23 seconds to go in the third quarter. My goodness, these two teams can't even snap the ball without somebody on either side moving.
Prior to the snap, ball start. Number 78 on the offense. 5 yards, repeat third down.
Julius Wilson flagged again. Royals back on the field. Apparently, all is quickly forgiven. And Coach Jim Leavitt. I wonder maybe an assistant coach couldn't have gone over there to talk to Royal and try to calm him down. They spread the field, two receivers to each side. It's caught by White. He lost the football into the end zone. Picked up by Verpail and run out to the 6-yard line. Pale might have been better served just falling on that in the end zone to bring it out. Instead, they get only to the 6-yard line. Mike Jenkins knocked the ball away from Roddy White as he was trying to struggle to get to the end zone.
And you know what? Again, stepping up in the pocket, Roddy White has the ball, plenty of time to tuck it away, loses it. Now, the rain has started coming back down, Sean. Not heavy like it was in the first half, anywhere close to it. Ball goes over in the left hand, which he had to have it with, but he got it punched out. And when it's wet out there on your jersey and all, the ball's going to slide through it.
Well, the Bulls take over at their own 6-yard line, hanging right in there with the favored Blazers. Hard earned 3 yards to the 9 for Hall on the final play of the third quarter. UAB led by three at halftime. The margin still three with 15 minutes to go in Birmingham. Coming down to Craig James, Heather Cox, our producer Jim Zeroli, our director Brad Sheldon in rainy Birmingham, Alabama. Start of the fourth quarter. South Florida with the ball down by three. Second down, a low throw and the catch made by Allenson Sheffield. Short of the first down by a couple. Craig, I have to admit, that was a little surprised Jim Leavitt put Terrence Royal back in the game. You know, that's not a great example. We talk about a young football team building toward the future. And let a player talk like that, show a lack of respect like that, and then put him back in the game, I don't think sends a great message to your football team.
You know, and you know, somebody might say, hey, it's easy for us to say up here, but I don't care. We both have been around a long time. You just don't let that happen. I can't believe Leavitt did it.
Joel missed the ball carrier out to the 21. Nice design and good execution of a third down play to move the chains. First and 10 from the 21-yard line.
And again, USF, South Florida going in there, trying to get to the line of scrimmage to create a little tempo, change it up. And if anybody, I don't want to say UAB's on the ropes, but they're not doing anything right now when they get the ball.
Hall tries the middle again for a couple. Certainly this Blazer defense done a much better job on Hall here in the second half. David Miller back up defensive end, sophomore from Cullman, Alabama, made the tackle. When we talk about the future of this UAB program, Watson Brown says, yeah, we compete in some ways against Alabama and Auburn for the top talent, but every year in the state there's about 70 to 75 high school players who get a Division I A scholarship. That's more than enough for Alabama, Auburn, and others. As a matter of fact, a lot of very good players leave the state and play in 1A programs elsewhere. So he feels because of their excellent location here, they can get terrific players, despite the fact that, by his own admission, the facilities here are really subpar. I mean, USF has this beautiful new $18 million football building, and these guys have pretty rough facilities here at UAB.
And you and I have been here and watched a lot of great football games in Legion Field. But for where UAB is, they need a 40,000-seat stadium that they can put 30, 35 in there and feel great about it and recruit off of it.
The deep ball thrown. Jewel Mist has a man up there. It is caught by Payton. Touchdown, and South Florida takes the lead with 12:49 to go on a 77-yard play.
Well, I'd lay out for crowd noise, but it's not here, so. Hey, you talk about protection and time to throw the ball.
It would be group noise.
Yeah.
In the case of tonight,
group hugs.
Second touchdown of the night for the true freshman, Payton. Second of the year, pardon me. First tonight. And the extra point up and good by Gramatica. South Florida leads now for the second time tonight. They led very early on in the first quarter, 3-0. They've been behind most of the night. They lead by four in the fourth. Longest completion of his career for Pat Julma, 77-yard touchdown pass. Right after the fumble by Roddy White when UAB was in field goal range. 94-yard drive on six plays, the 77-yard touchdown. So the lead for USF. Critical game for UAB with an eye toward the conference. Any chance really of staying in the race with Southern Miss and Louisville, already one loss for UAB in conference. Those other teams are undefeated in league play. Any chance of competing really goes out the window with the defeat here tonight. Jason Southall runs it out to the 24-yard line. We look at the KFC game track. A big play here. It had been a turnover-free night. White stripped of the ball by Jenkins, repelled the recovery that led to the touchdown. A well-thrown bomb by Julmist. Payton right on stride as he used his excellent speed to get behind Keys. freshman talent on display tonight. Chambers and Payton, each with touchdowns at the receiver position for USF tonight. Hackney forced to throw it up for grabs. And incomplete. Looking for Roddy White. Bruce Gibson with the coverage. And that's been a good battle all night long.
One thing for certain with UAB, in my opinion, what's keeping them from being a really good balanced program would be a lack of offensive running game, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, they're coming out and they're trying to hit the big plays. I know you admit that you're not a grind them out offense, but you have to be able to run the football.
Well, they don't really seem to have that big time make you miss, take one to the house running back. Burks and White are nice.
Short yardage goal line guys.
Yeah, they're not really game-breaking type backs. They alternate as the featured back, but the playmakers are really out wide. Interception as White slipped down. Bruce Gibson. Touchdown, South Florida. ...39 yards on the return by Gibson. Roddy White was the intended receiver, but he slipped as the ball was in the air, and it went right into the arms of Gibson.
Watch White with his curl. He went on his heels. You cannot cut on your heels. You got to keep your shoulder pads over your feet and your toes. And Gibson's over there. What is that, Sean? Their second interception this season?
Yes.
Second for the season.
You mentioned they had only one all year, tied for the national low. Both interceptions, though, have been returned for touchdowns. Trey Williams against Tennessee Tech, and now Gibson here against UAB. He's had a good night. Two quarterback pressures, five tackles, and the INT for the score. It's an 11-point lead. Conference USA matchup tonight here in Birmingham. UAB, the favorite, hosting South Florida, but the Bulls have taken an 11-point lead. Bruce Gibson, who was a cornerback the last couple of years, they moved him to wide receiver because they felt they needed depth there this season. He played there for a while. They've got some trickeration here on the return. Handoff on the reverse to Marcus Elliott, and that didn't fool anybody. He's at the 23-yard line. So they moved Gibson back to cornerback. He's played both ways, and boy, has he been important in that secondary. Here's Heather Cox.
Well, Sean, you talk about all the big games here at Legion Field. One of those took place in the late 70s with USF's very own Jim Leavitt. You talked about him being a two-sport stud at Missouri. Well, he actually was a safety on the Missouri team that came into this very field and beat a Bear Bryant-led Alabama team. So if you believe in a little field mojo, you got to believe this 11-point lead has a little something to do with Jim Leavitt winning here, both as a player and hoping to do it tonight here as a coach.
And this could be a huge victory for them. There's a long way to go against an explosive team. They've had a hard time finishing this year, as they demonstrated against Army, but certainly the momentum is on their side. There's their third sack of the night as Hackney goes down back at the 20.
And Sean, you'd have to think that and assume that Hackney at this point might have a little bit of doubt when he starts to set up and throw the football after that slip that Roddy White had on the last one.
Terrence Royal, part of that sack. He was involved in the animated exchange with Coach Leavitt not long ago. Corey White out to the 24. 4-yard gain, but still a third down and 8.
And third down and 8, you know, even though you might have some doubt about what's going to happen on the field, you still got to go out and find the guy that Roddy White. You know, he is the guy that makes the plays. You cannot be afraid to throw him the football. No question about it. Top of the screen up here.
Hackney throws short, caught by White. He needs to break the tackle, and he cannot. A great effort by White to get close to that first down marker, but he didn't get there. Sidney Simpson has had a good game at safety, and Javen Kamen made the tackle. Fourth down, still a long way to go, 10:40 to go.
You got to punt it.
Yeah, you do.
I know they might. Look what they do up top of the screen. You know, they know that Roddy White's their guy. Watch how they box him on this play. Linebacker kind of gives him a little love going out there. He's got to be aware of the slant, the angle coming to the inside. Linebacker doing two jobs at one time.
Well, they huddled before they ran onto the field as a punt unit. I'm sure USF would be alert to any kind of a fake. You can hear them yelling, watch the fake, and it is not a fake. Punted away by Parker Mullins. Chambers took it on the bounce. Breaks a couple of tackles and finally is taken down at the 32-yard line. 48-yard punt and 11-yard return. South Florida with an 11-point lead in the ball when we come back. We welcome you back to Birmingham. The officials did not recognize that we had gone away for a TV timeout. So play continues at Andre Hall on first down, ran off left tackle for four. It'll be second down and six for South Florida, content to take its time now. Little miss, letting the play clock run down to nine before he takes the snap. Hall, first down and more, breaking tackles and finally pushed out of bounds by Bobby Keys. It's a first down out to the 49-yard line. 13 yards on the run, where Andre Hall has had a more difficult time finding running room here in the second half.
Look at the right guard. 74 pulls around. The H-back, 48, comes around. The guys in the white jerseys are playing football right now, and the guys over on the other side, the green, are not. And they better watch out, because a big run by Hall is very conceivable.
He's rushed for 162. All ripping through a hole again. You're right, it is a very uninspired looking UAB defense. It's really in a must-stop situation here, Craig.
You know,
this is a team that's talking about competing for conference titles and going to a bowl game, playing on national TV, and they look a little flat.
It's not the top 25 team. I put them in there a few weeks ago. I know that. The talent is there, but you've got to get somebody coming up to make a play. There has to be a sense of pride and urgency on that defense. They got to recognize, like you're saying, Sean, we're not out here just trying to compete and improve our record. We're working on a conference title.
Which is just about completely out of the window with a loss here tonight. Chance to get bowl eligible. Clinton Crossley, the ball carrier, he has the first down at the 41. It's quite possible that Conference USA will not be able to fill all five of its bowl tie-in slots. Right now, certainly Southern Miss, Louisville, and Memphis all look like they're in good shape at 5-1, 5-1, 5-2, respectively. UAB 5-3, they should get the bowl eligibility too, but after that, you have Cincinnati at 4-4, TCU at 4-4.
And TCU's at Louisville next week.
Yeah, they have tough schedules left. There are the five bowl affiliations. USF, with a win tonight, could get to 3-4 and start to at least start thinking about a bowl game again. This was absolutely a must-have for them, with an eye toward the possibility of playing in a bowl game. Julmis, driven back. No gain on the play. Shamar Abrams with the primary hit. USF certainly has kind of a mixed bag of schedule left after tonight. They need to get to at least 6-5 for the bowl game. They have East Carolina at home. They go to Cincinnati. Then they have two tough home games against Memphis and that rescheduled game against Pittsburgh that was to be at the beginning of the year, moved because of the hurricane to the end of the year. They could get this one. They would still need to win three out of the last four.
Yeah, nice job barking. Get you a free five. You know, we've seen many times that South Florida's defense messed up on defense.
Prior to the snap, offside. Number 93, contact, 5 yards, still second down.
Well, with a small crowd, you can hear them. And we would say this again, the reason we assume for such a small crowd would be the rain, the torrential rain we had in the first half.
Yeah.
I mean, it was a rain.
I think this crowd will be a disappointment nonetheless. As we said, they've had some of the best crowds that they've had in the history of the program this year. But a very sparse gathering here tonight. There's Hall looking to take it into the end zone. And he will, touchdown South Florida. And terrible tackling by UAB. Looked like they had a number of shots at him. But Hall took it to 35 yards for a touchdown. And this has developed into a huge surprise with 6:50 to go. They're an extra point away from an 18-point lead.
What I say a couple minutes ago, they better watch out or Hall's going to hit him for a big run. When you've got a guy running the ball as hard as he is with that kind of movement and vision, and somebody else is just loafing around on defense, you're in trouble defensively.
Second 200-yard game of the season for Hall. He had 200 on the button against Army. He has 206 tonight on 26 carries. Well, for the second game in a row, UAB struggling defensively. Andre Hall, a big part of that 249 yards on the ground tonight for USF. You have to wonder what's happened here to UAB. They were 5-1, best start as a Division I-A school since they moved up nearly a decade ago. Going to Tulane, you figure they win that game. They come back home here, probably win this one too. They're looking at two straight losses in their season off the tracks.
Don't want to make an excuse for them, but South Florida really benefited from Mother Nature. That first half when they were getting all that rain coming down and it took away UAB's ability to throw the ball deep, I think that really kind of set the tone for this football game.
Reggie Lindsay can't even get to the 15. The ball squirted out, but he's down. After just a 6-yard return. Well, they have an explosive offense, and they're going to need all of that explosiveness here in the final 6:44.
Which they do. They do have that, and a big arm.
Watson Brown trying to get his team back up. Flag down. It looked like they were offside, the Bulls on the kickoff. Even though this is a major upset win for USF tonight, Jim Leavitt will still be irate about all the penalties. This is number 10.
In practice, if they have a penalty on the offensive line, they were telling us Leavitt was that he has the unit run together. They run together. You make a mistake, you run together. Something has to change. You know, maybe it's the coach has to run.
Well, he made them all run and it'd be a cross-country team. And this is ridiculous, week in and week out, and a lot of stupid little things like being offside on the kickoff.
Yeah, I mean, three things I was raised on. You got to be smart as a player, tough as a player, and aggressive.
You were raised on those?
Yeah, and I almost forgot the third one.
When do you plan on starting to do those things? There's Southall bouncing outside. And out of bounds at the 35-yard line. So the second chance is a big break for UAB. Instead of starting at the 14-yard line, they'll start at the 36. Hackney, 15 of 29 passing for 199. It looked like before the night started, it might be when the night started, early in the game, it might be a big night for him, bigger than that, because he had White running free all over the place. It looked like USF couldn't cover him.
Including a 70-ish yarder, maybe, yep, called back for a touchdown.
And the rains came, they got away from the passing game, and they haven't been able to establish any kind of rhythm in the passing game since. And that problem continues as Chavez couldn't handle a pass that wasn't right into his gut. 6.5 to go. That's a lateral. And a loss. Reggie Lindsay couldn't get out of the backfield. Sidney Simpson adding to what has already been an excellent night.
You know,
Lindsay gesturing toward the sideline. Don't know what that's all about.
Yeah, what a difference, though, in defensive tempo, aggression. Watch out front. You're going to see a little bit of crossing here. You're going to see them trying to cross up UAB's offensive line. But the number of white jerseys getting to the football in the flats. Early in the game, they weren't quite getting there. It was a little bit more of a receiving defense.
Big third down here. Down by three scores. Hackney going to try to run for it. He won't get there. He's 6 yards shy. Now Watson Brown has a decision to make on fourth down and six. I think you have to go for it, don't you, Craig? 5.5 to go. You need three scores.
The spirit of the week and math being critical to everybody, I would say yes. The numbers don't add up for them to punt the football.
They're 1-for-3 on fourth down this year. Five wide receivers, shotgun for Hackney. Four-man rush. They put pressure on. The pass is caught for a first down. Roddy White out to midfield. 12-yard gain. Danny Verpale knocked him out of bounds. So a must-have conversion for UAB.
One of the things you can look at, one of the keys to the game, besides the running game that they had, which was critical, those first six games, they kept giving it over. It was Halloween, handing out candy. Tonight they come up plus two, and which one of them being, well, they were both big. The fumble that they had that they recovered going in while UAB was going in.
Well, UAB was going to score. Instead, they fumbled. Quick touchdown score by South Florida off the fumble. And an interception run back for a touchdown. And Hackney taken down from behind by Terrence Royal. Well, maybe it's a good thing Coach Leavitt didn't send him to the locker room. His second sack since he had the argument with the coach.
Yeah, but you know, inside, Leavitt's got to be saying, look, you can't act like, of course, nobody was there to block him either. He better make a sack.
I agree. Still should have given him the royal flush to the locker room. Second down and 18. Hackney has a man caught near the first down marker. Norris Drinker, the sophomore from Dothan, Alabama. Steven Nicholas, the linebacker in coverage. Very close to a first down at the South Florida 40-yard line. Third down and less than a yard.
One of the difficult things here, Sean, for UAB, you know, the program-wise, is they play in the shadow of Alabama and Auburn. And to have a stinker like this at home playing in that shadow is not a good thing.
White might have had enough of the first down, tripped up by Nicholas. You know, they're still a relatively young program. And as Watson Brown said, you know, part of my job as the coach and athletic director is selling tickets out in the community, corporate sponsorships. Well, here's a chance tonight on national TV. Chance to get a win that guarantees you a winning season. And his team is laying a major egg.
Well, it's a good thing he's got a great relationship with the AD. That's kind of how I'd like to have.
Yeah.
If I took
the AD is on your side when it happens to be you. Here's a first down. You know, there's even conversation. We've heard it a couple of times when we walk around town here. That perhaps some people in this University of Alabama system, it is the University of Alabama at Birmingham, don't want UAB football to do well. They don't want another competitor for the Crimson Tide.
Which is really unfortunate if, for those who might have that mindset, because there's a lot of talent, as you pointed out earlier, in the state, and they can have several good teams here.
They have a man open, and it is behind Chavez, and then he got laid out. Well, Chavez has had a couple of chances tonight to make some big plays. He had a blatant drop earlier in traffic. And that one was a little bit behind him, in part because he seemed to overrun it. But if you're going to get wobbled, as he has on both occasions, you might as well catch it first.
Well, yeah, you know, that's easy to say. But he knew that he was going to get drilled. Oh! Vrabel came over and just, and guarantee he knew that was coming, didn't he?
Yeah.
And like you say, hey, if you're going to get hit, go ahead and catch football.
It makes the hit seem a little less rough. and you have a nice catch for a touchdown. White runs there another first down. He had 9. Now the clock really the ally of USF, under 3 minutes to go. They're moving, but they're moving slowly. And you'd think they might move with a little more urgency back here to the line of scrimmage. Third down, a short 2. Hackney throws short. Lance Rhodes couldn't hang on to that one. And another must convert fourth down. Fourth down and 2 with 2.5 to go.
Oh.
Greg Coble rolling up on the back of Hackney, who is limping a little bit, as you can see. He has had knee problems in the past, had a thumb injury last year that cost him about half the year. Boy, he's really limping. Already has, as you see, the brace on the right knee. Hackney looked like he could run for it. Instead, he lofts it up for White, and it's incomplete. And South Florida will take over on downs, and that should do it. Gibson had the coverage. Looked like Hackney had running room to go for the first down. He wanted the bigger play. I wonder if the knee was a factor back in the moment. Well, the reality is set in on the UAB sideline. This will be a second straight upset loss. Team trying to take steps up, get up to another level, get to a bowl game, compete for a conference championship. You can't do it by having the back-to-back games they've had against Tulane and South Florida. Hall with a short gain as he adds to his yardage total, up around 210 now. DeMarcus Rogers, a backup linebacker, made the tackle. While we have a moment, we want to wish a happy anniversary to our fine sideline reporter, Heather Cox, and her husband, Bill.
Yep.
Celebrating their 9th anniversary tonight.
Yep. And she's just looking beautiful on her anniversary.
I can't think of anybody I'd rather spend it with, guys. Well, except for Bill, than you.
Oh, thank you, Heather. She couldn't even get that sentence out. You know she didn't mean it.
She didn't mean it.
It's the thought that counts.
That was nice.
All again. UAB has 3 timeouts left, and they will use one now. I mean, this is really a crusher. You can't emphasize it enough for this UAB program.
Well, when you give up 212 yards on the ground to your opponent, not many times you're going to win, right?
Mm-hmm.
And for South Florida, great job by Jim Leavitt of getting his team ready to come in here on the road. Short week, it's a burden on them more than UAB. Wednesday night football game, you know, they've got to come in and short flight. They got to fly in here. I mean, Leavitt did a heck of a job of coaching in this game, except for he didn't take Royal out when he should have.
And we already showed you their remaining schedule. It's still going to be a tough climb to get above 500 for bowl eligibility with the win tonight. They'll get to 3-4. But you also look ahead now. They still need another win to the Blazers of UAB to become bowl eligible. They have Houston here in 10 days. And after that, they go to Army, playing a lot better now for Coach Ross. At Southern Miss, they'll be the underdog in that game. So, you know, it isn't a layup.
No, heck no. And Houston can throw the heck out of the football. Almost beat Southern Miss at Southern Miss a few weeks ago. Army's playing better, inspired football. There's no easy one here. No.
This was one that could have put them into bowl eligibility for sure. And as we mentioned, Craig, and then likely to go. They haven't been selected sometimes in the past.
That's their first time out.
South Florida couldn't get the playoff, so they use a timeout. They haven't been selected in the past, but they could have made it just about a certainty tonight, because we said this is a league that's going to struggle to get 5 teams that'll be eligible for a bowl. Well, Darrell Hackney talked about the goal for this UAB team to win a conference championship. Just about every starter coming back from a year ago looked like they had the team to compete for that. Certainly started the season that way, but it is getting uglier by the moment. Hall on a historic night skips into the end zone for a touchdown. 63 yards, giving him 275 for the night.
Well, by our count up here, 12 missed tackles on the evening. Of course, some of that you have to give credit to Hall because he's a good, strong runner. He's determined. That guy's playing football tonight. They said he had enormous. That was the word. I wrote it down. It was one of those you usually don't get. Enormous ability.
And the extra point up and good from Gramatica. It has become a rout. They were down by three. Entering this quarter, they've scored 28 unanswered points.
Oh, that's some bad effort and terrible tackling.
Yeah, it really looks like the defense has kind of packed it in here in this fourth quarter.
Yeah, and for South Florida, how do you overcome youth inconsistencies? You run the football, right?
Mm-hmm.
You build around Andre Hall.
You mentioned earlier he set the record for 200 yards against Army, the most ever against the 1A foe. He has shattered his own record with 275 tonight. But this is a conference where they can put up some big stats in a hurry. You mentioned October 16th, the game against Army. Hall had 200. Carlton Jones for the Black Knights rushed for 225 in Army's win. It was the first time this season in 1A that a pair of opposing running backs each rushed for 200 or more in the same game, just the sixth time that had happened in NCAA history. Of course, the last game for UAB, both Hackney and Lester Rickard of Tulane passed for 400 plus yards. A lot of stats in this league.
How many? He has brothers and sisters. How many did you say Andre Hall?
He's one of nine children. He's the seventh of nine.
Seventh out of nine?
Mm-hmm.
Man. Proud family tonight.
Larry Davis with pads popping. Brings the kickoff back to the 42-yard line. 24-yard return.
It's not often you leave a game where the ESPN crew in itself, we will make the traffic jam.
Yeah, I mean, there weren't a lot of people here to start with, and I mean, I would say there are fewer than 1,000 fans here now, wouldn't you? Well, let me even amend that. This was the crowded side earlier that we're looking at. And we can't really see that side because they're right below us. I'd say there are fewer than 300 people here.
The rain definitely kept folks away.
Curtis Fellaini is the quarterback. And Nicholas almost had the interception. Trey Cheney, the intended receiver. Curtis is a sophomore, 6'2", 205 from Birmingham. He started last year for Alabama Birmingham in their win at South Florida in Tampa. Hackney was out with an injury. Fellaini led them a victory.
And what a reversal of the way these two teams came together. Last year, it was UAB struggling.
Mm-hmm. Turnovers.
Turnovers. And then they win the game. Yep. Same thing now this year with South Florida, and they win the game.
Shovel pass. Marculus Elliott. Didn't get very far. Steven Nicholas made another tackle. Not sure if I was South Florida, I would have my best linebacker in the game ahead by 25 points with under a minute to go.
He's had 10 tackles tonight. Now he's been around the ball. He's played hard. Of course, they don't have a whole lot of guys they can go pull off the bench.
No, but they've had problems with injuries all year. Why risk it to this guy in garbage time?
Yeah.
Third down and 12. Trouble with the snap. That might be the last play. And if it is, it would be a fitting conclusion for UAB, the way this night unraveled.
Partner, I enjoyed it. You're buying dinner here in a little bit.
All right.
I don't know why, but.
And they're not going to snap it again. Terrific win for South Florida. They avoid losing four straight for the first time in the history of their program, which is what they were looking at with an L tonight. Final score, the South Florida Bulls 45 and the UAB Blazers 20. as this has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. Craig James, Heather Cox, and our entire crew, Sean McDonough, good night from Birmingham. For summaries and stats of this game, log on to ESPN.com. Your home for college football on the internet.